I read his reply repeatedly, and there's no redeeming it. Tullus has eagerly given Constans up for dead, and almost gloats over it. He is my brother. He doesn't seem to get that. The Senate doesn't seem to get that. They tell me to be him, be their consul, while they jostle over which of their litter should replace Constans. He's still alive. He's still fighting for us out there. They throw my brother to the wolves because they couldn't earn his respect. They call him crazy for not listening to them and forget that they have never given him a reason to listen to them. This is the road to destruction that Dad always warned us about, where the bad side of politics washes out the good. It only ends when enough people are dead or someone rips the reins away from the grasping patricians. And is Julianus going to do it? He would have already if he had any plans to protect his family, you get it? Tullus's respect for the process extends to letting the state die, if that be the will of the elected Democrats. And I'm fairly sure Julianus has Uther locked up somewhere, since he hasn't sent a word to me in years. Basically, it's a mess. And I have to choose my priorities, you hear me? And I will choose to make good on bonds of brotherhood. Everyone else might gain satisfaction from watching Constans struggle against the tides, but I'm going to remind them that Romans are supposed to care about honor. You don't have to come with me, but do not dare try to tell me to stay here. I'm going to Constantinopolis. Consulship be damned. Let Tullus be proconsul until the two chosen consuls return from the east in victory. Hello there, and welcome back to Fields of Mars. In the previous episode, we saw an attack on Tramontium by the forces of Aaron. They were able to overcome the garrison and sack the settlement, which they have now done many times and even did again right after that victory. Meanwhile, Constans was pressing east, heading out of Constantinopolis first to engage an army of Atropatene. He destroyed some of their reinforcements outside of their fort and then stormed inside, where they could not resist the advance of his heavy infantry and were wiped out. He then headed straight on to engage in another similar battle, this time against a settlement where most of the enemy's forces would be reinforcements. A lot of them slipped past him though. He stopped a few from getting to the town, wiped out a few others, and now must prepare to make the town assault. Since we have onagers, we can start off by just taking out enemy towers without any threat of punishment from the enemy, who are just going to stand there. So first, this tower here is our target. We'll shoot it with flaming shot. It's not quite as good as in the fort in the battle in the last episode, where just shooting anywhere will set everything on fire and destroy everything here. You do need to be a bit accurate, but you can see because the enemy are behind the tower from my perspective, the shots that miss have a decent chance of actually taking out a few enemy troops. So that is very nice. So soon we do manage to get the hits and start the fires we need to bring down that tower, and I noted that as the tower collapsed, they did actually kill a few enemies. Didn't realize that happened. If you're standing right at the base, it seems to kill you. I thought it happened in Rome too, but not Attila. But anyway, so with that tower down, we want to just take up more towers. The towers, of course, are really good against our legionaries, so we want to remove them from the areas we intend to attack. I had enough ammo to take down two, and then I had a few extra shots that I decided to just fling into the enemy's packed together ranks in these streets, and using the regular shot instead of flaming shot now, because it bounces when it hits the ground and takes out very many enemies as it goes along, especially with everyone packed together like that. So now it's time to begin the assault. Since we're out of ammo, you can see I put the mercenaries off on the flank. They're going to do the diversionary assault down one street, and I'm basically sending the entire army down another street. Nothing special or complicated about this attack plan at all. So first we move up, throw javelins into the enemy's frontline units. That unit, for whatever reason, was actually standing with its back to us, so it takes enormous casualties from that. They couldn't use their shield, so that was very nice of them. And they're going to jog back into the town and be replaced by a more competent unit, perhaps, as the javelin bombardment continues. And the rest of the army will just kind of bumble around. AI doesn't necessarily work in these little compact street compartments, so we'll just have to do our best to attempt to kill it while it jostles with its troops here. You can see once again it moves the unit up to the front line, takes a hit, says no, we don't want that unit on the front line, and quickly tries to replace it with another. So a little bit of a mess, but we can use that mess to our advantage, of course, by pressing in against them. At the same time, we're going to attack with those mercenaries from the east side of the town here, some archers attempting to jog away from these cavalry, and that's not going to work, of course. They'll be in trouble, and the mercenary infantry will now advance. The axemen and the Thracian falxmen will rush into the enemy troops defending that street, and those troops are not going to last very long against units with such high attack values. So here we are a few moments later, just pushing through a few of those enemies. The main objective though is to get to the enemy commander. You can see at the end of the street there, I think it's actually the commander of the reinforcement army from Atropatane. So this is the commander of the survivors of the guys we fought in the last episode, and they're now going to be in trouble fighting against the Axemen and the Falxmen. And if we push through far enough, we will of course be able to hit the rear of the enemy's main blob, and it is indeed a classic blob in this case. They've just sent all of their units out through this street to fight with one of my units of legionaries, which will now attempt to hold them in place. There's so much stuff though that it's going to put a decent amount of pressure on the unit of my side that's at the front here, so we need to be careful that this unit of legionaries isn't wiped out, especially as their stamina goes down, because the enemy do have some decent swordsmen in their ranks. So I wanted to try and do the always dodgy move of replacing the unit that's fighting at the front with another one. And we just about managed to pull it off here by charging in a more healthy unit and then ordering the unit already fighting to withdraw after that. And it seems the unit that was already fighting kind of phases to the back once you charge a new unit in, so that makes it safe for them to leave. So it's strange because I've never been able to do that with other factions. Perhaps the Roman legionary units just have the health and armor to actually pull off that maneuver. But anyway, we're also going to push from the other direction with those mercenaries, as I mentioned, so we need to break through the units that have come to try and stop us. But once we do, we will have free rein into the back of the main bulk of the enemy's forces. At the same time, I had one unit sneak into the center of the town where the enemy's garrison commander was waiting, and while he was locked down, he got hit in the back by cavalry, so that's not going to be good. I noticed some arrows flying into the scene. There's a sneaky unit of horse archers standing away from the battle, just sniping my men. Not going to change the result, of course. So we defeat the garrison commander, and now we can capture the center of the town. Doesn't win us the battle for small settlement assaults. It'll just improve our morale, or remove an enemy morale buff, I think, specifically. So anyway, the grind will have to continue. You can see on the balance bar that we have a gigantic advantage. So if we leave this, we will eventually grind through them, apparently. But of course, we might as well be a bit more proactive and really attempt to bring these guys down. I bring up the Matiarii all the way around to the back of the enemy's blob so that we can start javelin, and they have such a big formation that's going to be easy to hit for javelins that these shots are pretty much guaranteed to kill something. So I'm hoping for big damage here, and that of course will annihilate both their troop count and morale. I don't even have that many troops left. I think the enemy general died somewhere in the mix. Hard to really tell what's going on here. So I'm just ordering my troops to basically surge forwards now and just attack everything. The enemy starts routing. Not going to help because they're routing into the town and we already have troops inside the town. But the battle ends, luckily for them, before I decide to go and slaughter them. That army is going to be deleted now. So we've completed the objective of defeating the main force from Aria. And as a sneaky bonus, we now have this town of Nicomedia at our mercy. Hail the liberators! Hail the return of honest Romans! We shall not force you into hovels as one of the nameless masses. We shall rebuild this city together with you to restore the glories that I know many of you still remember. Yes, the tragic present will be banished so that the future can meet the standards of the past. And make sure you understand this well, for whatever the Easterners have been promising you needs to be forgotten. We only deal in what is real here. There will be work, there will be sacrifice, there will be obedience. But in the end, there will be that one thing we all chase. Greatness! The free Romans of Pontus will rise, and I will make sure of it. If anyone tries to stop you, just let me know. The Legion marches far and without mercy. Nothing left from the enemy's garrison of one unit, and the enemy's reinforcement army took big damage, especially to those archers who all died right at the start. Those survivors will escape since they're outside the town, despite technically being inside in the battle. don't think about it too much. So anyway, it's time to decide what we have to do for our option. And we have the interesting option of liberating the faction of Pontus and creating it as a puppet state here. So that could be quite useful as a buffer to stop factions going for us as they come from the east. The other viable option is to sack it. We are very low on money because upkeeping all of these legions is extremely expensive, and I've actually now drained pretty much all my cash. But I do decide to go with that liberation in the end. So this will be very nice. We can have Pontus basically fight the Eastern factions for us and use their magic AI money to make life easier. They'll have basically a full stack of that one town. So that will make our defenses much stronger. And will allow Constans to focus a little bit more on Thracia, the province of Constantinopolis, and try and stabilize it. Public order has been deteriorating pretty much constantly for a while. And it's a lot to do with the fact that this Aran army is just causing havoc. We can't stop it until Constans actually gets over there, and we can't go over there until Constantinopolis is safe. So hopefully that will contribute to solving that problem. I notice here that Atropatene have stopped besieging the Eastern Roman Empire, so that was very kind of them. The Eastern Roman Empire have got their garrison back as well as a result of that. So looks like the Empire won't be falling immediately, as it looked like it might be about to in previous turns, so that's nice. They do have forces about that could go and conquer other regions as well, apparently not bothering to defend their own territory. Now, as we learned at the start of the episode, Aurelianus has a new plan to go and attempt to save Constans. He is going to defy the Senate's insistence that he is now the sole consul for a while, supposed to be controlling all of these territories. He is just going to forget about it and go after what he finds to be more important, and perhaps deep down inside, just looking for some of that glory that Constans seems to be constantly getting out there. So we'll see what he can do with that as he makes his journey in that direction. And once again, Aran has decided they are going to attack Tramontium. Once again, I am going to auto-resolve it, though, because our garrison is in no shape to really fight. There's not absolutely no chance here, but I'm not going to take it, especially knowing that Tramontium's map isn't particularly good in terms of defense, because it doesn't have many choke points. There's five or six ways to the center of the town, so we have to spread our forces thin, and with 20 men per unit, that's not going to be enough to cover all the angles. So really, we need Aran to just stop attacking us, or we need to take them out. And they actually seem to run away, perhaps realizing that if you keep sacking the same settlement over and over again, you actually don't get anything for doing it. So maybe they got bored of receiving zero loot and went off to do something else. But the public order situation around Constantinopolis is still terrible. I'm looking at the causes here, and it's basically every possible cause in the game. It's a combination of everything. We really need to stabilize the region. That's probably the biggest thing, though. We need to stop Tremontium from being attacked, and ideally we need to rebuild Marcianopolis, which is the ruined city to the north, so we can start restoring the infrastructure, get the sanitation back, and get our religious influence to be more powerful as well, because Zoroastrianism keeps sneaking its way in there. So now moving on, the Angles once again appearing up near Britannia. It seems though that they're actually migrating because their forces go and land there in southern Iberia. So it's possible they're not doing offensives against me. They're just moving armies down to try and capture territories somewhere that isn't so affected by climate change. And now we see Aurelianus in trouble. He landed in Macedonia, walked across it, and then set sail for Constantinopolis, following the same route as Constans. But as you can see, he was attacked by forces of Aran once again, causing trouble for us. He was able to escape somehow, despite looking like he was completely trapped on the map. He just sailed past them, and they forgot about him. So that was all well and good. Then we see the Gaetulians, our allies in Africa, moving out and smashing up the Western Roman Empire forces that were hanging around outside the ports of Palma. Some of them so close that in fact the Palma garrison fleet can come out to take part in the fight. So we might as well do that to attack our enemy and to get a little bit of respect from our ally there for helping them out. So that's half a stack of Romans disappeared. Very nice for us, so thanks to our ally for helping us out. But another African neighbour not being so nice. It's the Garamantians this time who suddenly declare war on us. I don't really know why. We don't really border them or anything. We've never really interacted with them. They've just suddenly decided they're going to come for us. Perhaps they've decided that they want southern Attalia for themselves. That would be the most logical option for them. Now the problem here is that they are allied to the Gaetulians just like I am. So I decided I am going to try and test the alliance by calling the Gaetulians to declare war on Garamantia, but they turn that down, unfortunately, so we lose those allies. The Gaetulians aren't going to be at war with us, but they might be as a result of this in the future. We are now just neutral. Luckily, the Garamantians didn't actually have anything planned immediately. It was just a declaration of war, so no attacks actually come for now. So Constantinopolis continues to deteriorate and actually had a rebellion, which you can see off to the left of the screen, has taken Tramontium and turned it into a rebel settlement. So we've lost it entirely, and Zoroastrianism has continued its spread and is now the dominant religion in Constantinopolis. And that's fueled by the fact that all of these Eastern agents are wandering around constantly trying to kill my agents and spreading their religion. So that is not nice at all. Aurelianus needs to get up there and help out. He's going to have to go over land because the sea routes are too dangerous. There are, of course, hostile cities in between, but luckily they seem to be unguarded, so he can either bypass them or just quickly take them. There's only small garrisons there, and move on to help Constans. So it could be a little bit of a tall order for his small army, but he should be able to achieve it if he's lucky. And Tullus, while Aurelianus is away, is going to have to pick up the slack. He now has a massive area of territory that he has to guard, all of Italia and Sicily, and realistically he has to guard the islands as well. He's there going to take on some rebels down near Syracuse. Plenty of hostile fleets, including the Garamantians, sitting there just to the south of the islands. We can have Tranquillius there defend Carolus, but overall it looks like we're going to be quite vulnerable for the time being. Chaos does not begin to describe it. Even troops brought from Britannia seem to be caught up in rebellions for every cause, and where people are not fearing the intent of their neighbour, they fear foreign armies rumoured to lurk over every horizon. This, I am saddened to say, is worse than living under a corrupted empire. That the people agree with this view is demonstrated by the speed with which any commander who declares that he will restore the old order suddenly has an army at his side. It makes putting them down a hard sell to our men, but discipline holds. Last word from the Senate suggested they were no closer to agreeing on what to do about it all. So for now, I am proconsul, the one who will absorb all the blame. As we advance on, it turns out that the Garamantians' declaration of war on us was not as empty as it has been from some other factions. They do have a plan, it's just a little bit slow to happen. So they're going to make a naval attack on Palma using this stack here. So it's another classic port defense, the hallmark of this campaign. The enemy has tons of desert levy, which is nothing too much to worry about, although they are a medium spear unit rather than a light spear unit, as it might suggest, and they have a few other units, including a bunch of hurlers, which could be dangerous. Now, something that's interesting about this fight is that their general is a cavalry unit, and that means their general isn't going to be coming in by sea. So this is going to prevent us from doing the usual trick. We can't just send our ships out to kill the enemy general at the start of the battle. We do have those ships, so we might as well use them for something. So they're just going to sail out and stop some random enemy infantry units, picking the ones that are far away from the hurler ships, because those hurlers will annihilate our navy crew if we get too close. So instead, we'll have to fight the enemy's general on land. We can't make use of seasickness. However, thanks to how Attila's AI works, I was not at all worried about this. In fact, this is perhaps better than the general coming in by ship, because you're virtually guaranteed to kill the general when he deploys ahead as a cavalry unit. Because for some reason, the Attila AI, when making these port assaults, always sends the cavalry in before the rest of the army. So as long as you have a spear unit somewhere between the center of the town and the cavalry, you can guarantee to kill them all. So here we are, all of these cavalrymen just charging in to fight these Western Palatine Auxilia, who are in Testuda formation, which gives them an extra bonus against cavalry. Those lancers actually seem to be going past. They might be going around to the other side, but they're getting pelted by darts all the way they're doing it. Now, the Marines actually had a kind of hard time. I didn't really expect this. I imagined that Desert Levy would just go down immediately to these guys. But they actually seemed to be doing sort of one-for-one battling, where they were actually inflicting pretty hefty casualties on the Marines. Eventually, we are going to rout this unit. We don't have to kill all of them, of course. But still, I was surprised at how well they held up. Perhaps they are immune to seasickness. Certain units are, but you wouldn't imagine the Desert Levy are immune to seasickness. Anyway, now the General has done exactly what we thought he would. He's come in with his cavalry to fight with my spearmen. I'm putting an extra unit behind them, because sometimes cavalry will push through to the other side, so just give them something to fight if that happens. And now we just wait. The only way the enemy general can save himself now is to disengage, so it's up to him to make that decision. Meanwhile, the rest of the army is going to be coming in and landing, and here are all those hurlers. So the hurlers are potentially dangerous. Pretty much everything in our army is going to be weak against attacks against hurlers. We've managed to not really see hurlers very much in the campaign so far, so I've never really had to deal with them, but they are very powerful. They just have very limited ammunition, so you need to make them fire at something pointless for a while in order to stop them from taking out your heavy infantry. We do have archers up here on the wall who'll be able to snipe away at those hurlers, and probably the best solution is to send in the cavalry. What I'm trying to do here, not working all that well actually, because the first unit of hurlers kind of gets them stuck into the melee, and these other units turn, and a few of them start actually firing into it. So although they will inflict friendly fire, the cavalry there are a pretty big target, so they're going to get a decent amount of shots onto us there, especially as the hurlers underneath them are being quickly killed, so soon it's going to be pretty much just cavalry. Good news though, the enemy general finally commits suicide against the spear line. He does it, his unit shatters, and the other unit fighting there won't last long either, because my spears can push on and kill the rest of them. So that's good. That's going to make the rest of the fight a little bit easier. My marines, who defeated one enemy unit out at sea, have managed to find another one just before they landed, so we'll try and take them out as well, trying to make use of seasickness if it is there. Another ship in the background successfully taking out a target at last, but the loss is pretty heavy, surprisingly heavy, so maybe they can't take on another one. Now, the cavalry have taken decent losses from those hurlers and going to have to get out of there now, especially because their health is probably low and because the enemy deployed a spear unit right next to where I was fighting, so I wanted to get out of there. Ideally, I wanted the hurlers to kind of chase after these guys and target them and just run them away from the town, but they didn't take the bait, unfortunately. They are going to start their melee attack now. I've got this barricade here, and I did do the thing where the Legio threw their darts at guys at point-blank range. It looks like I'm taking some friendly fire here. It's the archers on top of the wall that are just firing at those units very indiscriminately. So we're going to pull back and fight the enemy on top of the hill. So we'll draw all of the enemies into the central area, which will prepare us for the classic scout equite tactic, where we can then rear attack these guys once they're engaged in melee. And with the enemy general dead, that is going to be particularly effective for us. You can see my cavalry in the distance having completely failed to draw the enemy away. Luckily though, the strength of the enemy's hurlers is being used almost entirely on my archers. We've managed to get a skirmish going, and this is really good, because even though the archers, as you can see, are taking pretty hefty losses against the hurlers, most of the hurlers' shots are going to be wasted because they are firing upwards at a difficult angle, and there's this barricade in front of my troops that will block a lot of the hits. Meanwhile, my archery is going to be slowly killing the enemy hurlers. So what we can hope here is to just drain all of the ammunition so they can't do anything else, and to kill a few of them with the archery fire just to make it easier for us to finish them off later on.
Listen! Listen to me! We're getting nowhere with this bickering. I think it is time you let your praetor speak. I understand that my brother has put us into a difficult situation, but you are so obsessed with defaming him that you fail to see how this is also an opportunity. Romans everywhere are splintered. So many empires and armies, all thinking of their own rivalries first and the enemies of Rome second. We are the most powerful remnants of the Empire, and thanks to Constans, we control the most important cultural centers of our world. The fate of the world is here in our hands, if we will only take a moment to stop wringing them. Our enemies are not Roman. We are Roman. It is time to stop pretending otherwise, just as my brother has already done.
So it's now time to deploy the scout equites to get things moving. I wanted one unit to take out these hurlers who were just standing here, and I was wondering if this would come across in the replay, and it actually did. The units kind of glitched out. They never really finished disembarking from the ships, it seems. So they're just standing there, and the ship's still there as well. And while a ship's disembarking, it can't receive orders, nor can you give orders against it, which means I can't give an attack order against these guys. The cavalry have just walked into them, and that will cause the attack animations to slowly kill some of them, but with dramatically reduced efficiency. Meanwhile, the other unit's rear-attacking the big blob of spearmen here. Potentially dangerous, because if they just turn around and charge down the hill, those cavalry will be in big trouble. Luckily, they don't. They are going to remain fighting primarily with the Legio up front. One unit shatters, and then being near that shattered unit will destroy the morale of the other two units. And curiously, they're doing the classic route forwards maneuver. So now my men will pile into this to start inflicting as much damage on these units as possible while we have them trapped, and that's going to be pretty easy. So that's most of the enemy's infantry gone, and really the most difficult unit to defeat was this glitched out hurley unit. I had to deploy two other units of infantry to come in and try and stand everywhere that that unit was standing to get all the melee fights going, but eventually the enemy just gives up and the other battlefront and never even had to rear attack. They just stopped fighting after a while, and that's the end of the fight. A heroic victory, pretty much expected by this point, especially for a port defense, but nice to see one that went slightly differently to the usual fare. Unfortunately, we didn't really do all that much damage to the enemy army in terms of units being totally destroyed. Only three or four actually wiped out, so they could quite easily get a new general, replenish that army, and just come back and do it again. But of course, if they were to do that, we know we have a way to defeat them. So now, in the next turn, hacking through the agent spam as usual, we get this interesting message. It seems that Zoroastrianism has become so popular in Constantinopolis that we need to basically make some sort of ruling about it. And it basically comes down to two choices. Do we want more Zoroastrianism or less? And I was a bit confused because I thought, surely there must be some like upside and downside to either. It seems to just be a straight choice. So I'm going to sanction Zoroastrians, which will cause there to be less Zoroastrianism in our territory. So hopefully that will help out and encourage the spread of Roman paganism. We'll see if anything ever comes of it. So meanwhile, we've got an economic and a food crisis going on all over the place. I need to repair up Palma once again being destroyed. That will solve the food crisis on the islands. The economic crisis going to take a bit more work to deal with, unfortunately. We also need to keep an eye on the Garamantians because, as I mentioned, they may just come back or attack one of the other islands. And we've also got a major rebellion at Syracuse, which has gotten pretty big. Luckily, Tullus is just standing there waiting to take them out. And they do stand and fight against him, which is clearly the wrong choice, especially with the garrison coming in to help out as well. So his powerful army will just wipe the rebels out. And once again, the rebels had an interesting selection of units, like heavy onagers and ballistas and crossbow troops. Some really nice units, especially for attacking cities, but unfortunately, they're not going to get to use them. Now, while Aurelianus lay siege to Thessalonica on his route to save Constans, I decided that our administration is going to make a very historic offer to the Western Roman Empire, an offer of peace to finally end the conflict, and that's mainly because we are now stronger than they are, so we have won symbolically. We have no need to take more of their territory. Really, now we want to be repairing our relations so that we can all focus on our mutual enemies, especially with the African factions now getting uppity. We may need to work with the Western Romans in Iberia against them. So they did accept our deal. It was one of Constans' body doubles accepting the deal specifically. And that also allows me to now get formal relations with the Eastern Roman Empire, because I'm not at war with their allies. I can get a defensive alliance with them. That will help out Constans, because some of the Eastern Roman Empire's forces are nearby, and will also negotiate military access later on. I can't get anything more with the Western Roman Empire for now, but of course we have just come out of an extremely long war, so they may cool down over time and perhaps will manage to get some sort of alliance going that will actually switch us from being in a really precarious position to being in an extremely strong position. Meanwhile, Aurelianus will continue on his mission, oblivious to all this, first defeating a small enemy garrison at Thessalonica, which gives us control of the city. I would have liked to just liberate something here, but there wasn't the option, so we'll have to occupy it, which is annoying because it's in a province I don't intend to hold, but similar to Tarentum in the past, we'll just give it a chance and maybe in the future we'll be able to stabilize it. The rest of the province is controlled by my puppet state and my new defensive ally, so it's not a particularly threatening position, but we won't be able to control public order and religion particularly well. We'll do our best. So now, after this, our territories basically come into a period of peace. There was a long time where we didn't see any action from the Sassanids, and now with the Romans not to worry about, we weren't constantly watching the West either, and the Garamantians went back to lick their wounds. So this was a great opportunity to develop the economy, try and get everything back in order so we stop having constant rebellions, and to generally reshuffle everything ready for further conflicts. And you can rest assured that further conflicts are coming, and all the while, Julianus back in Britannia is formulating a sneaky plan to further push this concept of unity between the Roman peoples, and of course pushing it in a way that might just benefit him more than anyone else. So we'll be jumping ahead to the next bit of action and the next phase of the story in the next episode. The power vacuum left by Constans and Aurelianus had paralyzed the Britannian noble classes. Arguments from all political schools were made, from complete reform to simply appointing someone as a new Western emperor and restarting the dormant imperial administration. Any action was delayed by the fact that both of the previously appointed consuls were alive and would occasionally write to the Senate listing the achievements they had made under that office. That same list was what the common people came to hear of too. Romans could get behind the project to recapture eastern territories, so much so that Constans was indirectly thawing the conflicts between the factions in the west. That was when Julianus realized there was a chance to steal the spotlight entirely. Thanks so much for watching. So we'll see what happens through a few years of reform and directional change for Britannia and its territories in the next episode of Fields of Mars.